Cambridge is essentially where cryopreservation was invented. Not 20 miles away from his house was the first time that anybody froze cells and thawed them out. So when I was doing my PhD, we published some 3 or 4 papers in a journal called Nature, which is one of the most eminent scientific journals, on freezing T cells, which are still being sort of cited now.
One of the things that's been really fun about the development of cell therapy within Cytiva is we started with a core coming out of the very mature and robust bioprocess group, but we've been continually acquiring small startup companies. And it led to things like the acquisition of Asymptote and their cold chain and cryo-logistics solutions.
Well, John, you were the scientific expert. Mm-hmm. So then we were the engineering team around you that enabled the equipment.
Yeah, I think we had a really powerful thing in so much as I knew the biology, and we could couple that with some really good engineering, you know, a lot of innovative engineering.
Yeah.
So
we spent quite a few weekends building stuff.
But we were often on the weekend, because whenever we drilled a hole, people complained about the noise.
That's true as well.
And the smell of the fiberglass.
We opened the door to try and get the smell out, and just got sucked through the entire building and everyone came down.
What happened in the early 2000s was that cell and gene therapy came along, and the UK government put a lot of money into supporting that embryonic industry. And one of the steps that they identified as being key was, how do you get the cell and gene therapy from the manufacturer into a patient? So it's like how do you freeze it? How do you deliver it? How do you thaw it out? How do you track it? The initial clinical trials failed because although the cell therapy worked, they couldn't get it into lots of patients in different sites.
Right.
Without it sort of degrading.
Okay.
Yeah. And that was a known bottleneck.
So your PhD, you've been 30 years
unread.
There you go. Timing is everything, right?
Yeah.
And that's where the cryo chain, and us as engineers and physicists, and you as a scientist, cryobiologist, can enable that. So quietly behind the scenes, the cryo chain makes that global scale possible. Traditionally, people have used liquid nitrogen, which has gone on for decades. But liquid nitrogen, it can burn you, it can suffocate you. You need deliveries of it every week.
You can't put it in a lift and get in the lift at the same time.
You have to rope the lift off, don't you? And send it up separately.
So the logistics of getting it around, say, a hospital is just terrible.
Well, I remember one thing you told me about. We did some experiments. You described it as a boiling toilet of filth.
Yeah.
Because you've got this liquid that's... Because any bacteria that fall into it can be cryopreserved. Okay, they might not be that effective, but once it's boiling, it's just like a toilet of bacteria boiling and spreading out. And we did some experiments with fluorescein.
The VIA-free systems are innovative because they use a cryocooler, Stirling cryocooler, as their main engine, and not liquid nitrogen. So that removes all the health and safety issues around liquid nitrogen and the deliveries and so forth.
And it means that you can now just, you know, go plug this into a wall circuit and achieve cryogenic freezing and storage conditions. And that was an incredibly powerful new technology that we were bringing into the fold.
But then the coldness, if you like, is conducted up to the sample, and it's spread very evenly. So then you have a very even distribution of the coldness, and that means you get very low sample-to-sample variation and batch-to-batch variation, and that consistency is really important across all the different treatments.
When we exposed it to the people in cell and gene therapy, they were very it was disruptive, I think is, you know, it was something they hadn't heard of.
The Cambridge-based asymptote team is probably the epitome of a science-driven engineering kind of genius hub, where they're in there and they're always thinking, what's the next thing? How can I make this technology better? How can I apply this technology?
And we also got some really good scientific papers, because they challenged some ideas around really fast thawing being essential, and again, flash freezing being key, and just sort of debunked some of the...
I think everybody in the industry kept telling us you had to thaw out cells very rapidly. And then we did some research collaboratively with the cell and gene catapult. And we found out if you cooled cells very slowly, you could warm them very slowly. And this meant we could develop warming equipment that could thaw relatively slowly. And that was as good as thawing very rapidly, because to thaw rapidly is very difficult, and with, you know, if you're not using, you know, hot water. So we scientifically it was a surprise to me.
We were playing with different ways of making thawing something in a dry manner, but trying to make it flexible.
Yeah.
Because the bag, when they freeze the bags, they're not perfectly flat. Yeah. So then between two flat plates, you don't get the contact. So then we explored. Yeah, different flexible methods of heating.
Well, there was, what was it called? The jet thaw.
Which
could thaw anything, but it was a bit.
Once you fired up the generator. I think it was when we took one of them, we showed them to some customers. It might have been with the catapult. And some of them, they were all dry, but some of them had water, but they were sealed in water bags. And the particular customer said, oh no, I don't want water anywhere. Ever. And just one day it will leak, or I have to refill it. And that's when we went.
Contamination.
So that's what pushed us to what is now the VIA Thaw, completely dry system without flexible bed.
Yeah.
But then the technology we could bring, because we're not doctors, we're not a cell therapy company, but like you say, there were early treatments which were never going to scale.
We talked a lot about CAR-T therapies then and how it might expand, because we wanted to get it out to the world in a bigger way.
Yeah.
And we couldn't really do it on our own that easily.
Yeah. So what do you think they saw from their side?
Yeah, I mean, rockstar scientists and really innovation scientists, right? I think it's kind of the passion as well as the expertise that they bring to bear is infectious on the rest of the team.
A lot of the patients who are being cured at the moment are children. And I think that also, you know, has an added like impetus. I think we've all got children.
Yeah.
Grandchildren.
Yeah. Yes.
So, you know, it's...
What an amazing industry to be involved with.
Yeah.
And not just involved with, we help stimulate it and provide the equipment for it.
Yeah.
So, I think I'd do it again.
Mm.
Yeah. I think, you know, the fact that our equipment's used for the delivery of, you know, life-saving medicines, I think it makes everybody very, very proud. And, you know, we're delivering, you know, medical miracles, really.